السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، صلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. أما بعد، the messenger of Allah عليه الصلاة والسلام he said, من يرد الله به خيرا يفقه في الدين. Whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala he wants goodness for, Allah Jalla wa Ala gives that person the understanding of the religion. Likewise, the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, he said, مَنْ سَلَكَ طَرِيقًا يَلْتَمِسُ فِيهِ عِلْمًا سَهَّلَ اللَّهُ لَهُ طَرِيقًا إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ. That whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or whomsoever takes a path in seeking knowledge, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he makes the path to Jannah easy for that person. We make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He makes us from them. Allahumma ameen. Then this masjid for the past few months has listened to a series of talks that were given since October. I believe the first talk being preparing for death. And then after that, it was to do with the paradise, the description of paradise, or the life of the grave, Afwan. The life of the grave. And then after that, it was the description of paradise, and then the description of the hellfire. And then today we end that series with the intercession before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The intercession that we're referring to is that intercession that will take place Yawm al-Qiyamah. The intercession of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for his ummah. And likewise, the other intercessions that will take place on that day. However, the intercession of the Messenger of Allah, alayhi salatu wasalam, is referred to as ash-shafa'atul udhma, ash-shafa'atu al-udhma, the greatest shafa'ah, if you would, or the greater shafa'ah. Before we mention that, let us, insha'Allah, first understand what is ash-shafa'ah, intercession. What is it? What does it mean and what does it entail? Ash-shafa'atu, this is an Arabic word. The ulama of the language, the scholars of the Arabic language, then they said, ash-shafa'atu, it comes from the word ash-shaf'u, which is khilaf al-watr. It means something that is two or paired. It is the opposite of something which is odd, meaning odd in number. Witr, of course, is something which is odd. It can be three, it can be one, three, or five. This is what is known as witr. And of course, ash-shafa'u is the opposite of witr. It is opposite of something which is odd in number. So therefore, it gives us the idea that it's dual or a pair. Likewise, the scholars of the language, they refer to it as يعني ضم مثله إلي. It is to join something of its like with something else. So it becomes two. Likewise, the word ash-shafa'a, it can refer to talab, seeking something. When you intercede for somebody, you're seeking something for that person. Likewise, the scholars, they said, كلام الشفيع للملك في حاجة يسألها لغيره. It is something that a person, he goes to, for example, he goes to a king. He goes to a king and he asks on behalf of somebody something, whatever that case may be. And another example that can be given is, for example, if you work in a business and you are an employee, for example, and you want to have a good relationship with the manager, or you want a promotion, or whatever the case is, you ask somebody who is close to the manager. You say, can you ask him on my behalf? So that person, he becomes a shafi', he becomes an intercessor for you. So then he goes to the manager, or he goes to the boss, or whoever it is, and he puts a good word in for you. And of course, this is a good type of shafa'ah, a good type of intercession. And there could be evil types of intercession as well. Asking on behalf of somebody for something evil or something bad. So shafa'ah in the language can refer to those things which are good and those things which are also bad. As for in the sharia, yani shara'an, what does it mean when we say shafa'ah Islamically? Does anybody know? What is the meaning of shafa'ah Islamically? Any idea? Intercession, shafa'ah, or ash-shafa'ah, Islamically, then it is defined as, like the ulama have defined it, هي السؤال في التجاوز عن الذنوب والجرائم. It is to ask on behalf of somebody for their sins and their crimes to be wiped away or lifted off, if you would. يعني التجاوز عن الذنوب والجرائم. You go to somebody and you ask them to make dua for you, for example. Make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah forgives you and takes away your sins and so on and so forth. It can also be defined as التوسط للغير بجلب منفعة أو دفع مضرة. It can mean that you seek moderation or an intermediary between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bring about something of benefit or to ward away harm. This is another definition of الشفاعة. It is more of a precise definition. When we define shafa'a in the Islamic terminology, then this is a more precise definition, that you are seeking moderation between yourself and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in order to bring about benefit for you or to seek or to hinder away any harm. This is what shafa'a means. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he uses this word linguistically in the Quran. Allah jalla wa ala, he said, man yashfa' shafa'atan hasanatan yakun lahu nasibun minha. Whomsoever intercedes with a good intercession, then he will get the reward thereof or from it. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, وَمَنْ يَشْفَعْ شَفَاعَةً سَيِّئَةً يَكُنْ لَهُ كِفْلٌ مِّنْهَا. Whomsoever intercedes with an evil intercession, you intercede for somebody on behalf of something which is evil, something which is wrong, something which is haram, or something which is not legislated, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, you will have the burden of that sin, or you will have burden of that sin from it. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses the word intercession in the linguistic meaning. So simply put, somebody who puts a word of good in for you, seeking a promotion or of the cases, or if you put in a word for somebody, you become an intercessor for somebody, and it will help them out in their daily lives, then you become an intercessor who is good. And whatever good comes out of your intercession for that person, perhaps he needs help, sadaqah or zakat or whatever the case is, you put a word in, perhaps his car is broken down, you ask others if they can help, and so on and so forth, then of course a person, he gets reward for this. If your intercession is successful, this is what is known as an intercession which is hasana, a good intercession. Because you're helping another person, you're helping another believer. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَتَعَوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى وَلَا تَعَوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ. Help one another in goodness and piety, and do not help one another in transgression and sin. So anybody who helps a person via intercession in a good way, then he receives the reward. He receives reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of that action, and any good that comes out of that intercession, he also receives that reward. Like the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, he said as well, أَدَّالُ عَلَى الْخَيْرِ كَفَاعِلِهِ. Whomsoever shows towards a good path, towards any goodness, then he is like the one who has done that goodness. So the mere showing of a person, or showing a person towards good, or telling him to do good, and that a person embarks upon that good, you get the reward of that as well. Likewise, the Messenger of Allah, alayhi salatu wasalam, he says, as it comes in one hadith, regarding the shafa'ah, the intercession, the Islamic intercession, which will happen on Yawm al-Qiyamah, he said, alayhi salatu wasalam, أُعْطِيتُ خَمْسًا لَمْ يُعْطِهِنَّ أَحَدٌ قَبْلِي. I was given 5 things that nobody before me was given, meaning no prophet before me was given these 5 things. And from amongst those 5 things, he sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, أُعْطِيتُ الشَّفَاعَةَ. I was granted the intercession. I was granted the shafa'a يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ. Likewise, the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasallam, he said, أَنَا سَيِّدُ وَلِدِ آدَمْ وَلَا فَخَرْ. I am the master of the children of Adam, and I do not boast. And then he said, عَلَيْهِ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ وَأَوَّلُ شَافِعٌ وَأَوَّلُ مُشَفَّعٌ. I am the first intercessor يوم القيامة, and the first one whose intercession will be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And of course, this proves and serves as evidence that يوم القيامة, the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, will be the first from amongst all of mankind to intercede. And that is only because of his station, alayhi salatu wasalam. Like he said, Ana Sayyidu Walidi Adam. I am the master of the children of Adam. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam is the best of mankind, the best of creation, alayhi salatu wasalam. And if that is the fact, and which it is a fact, then of course it means he should be the first to intercede. He should be the first to intercede out of all of the prophets and the righteous. And he said, alayhi salatu wasalam, not only is he the first intercessor, but his intercession is accepted. It is accepted by Allah Jalla wa Ala. And he's the awwal, yani mushaffa', the first one whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept his intercession. But of course, intercession is of two types. We have a shafa'a, which is muthbita, accepted. And we have a shafa'a, which is manfiya, rejected or negated. So there are two types of intercession: affirmed intercession and negated intercession. Because not all intercession will be accepted. In regards to a shafa'a al-manfiya, yani that shafa'a, that intercession that will be rejected and negated, then that is as defined by the ulama, hiya ash-shafa'atu ash-shirkiyya allati tutlabu min ghayri Allahi tabaraka wa ta'ala fima la yaqdir alayhi illa Allah. It is that intercession that is a shirki intercession, an intercession that contains shirk within it, polytheism. And that type of shafa'a is sought from other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in that which only Allah jalla wa ala is able to do. So the first shafa'a which is negated is the negated, that is the shafa'a which is shirki. It contains shirk and polytheism within it. And that is any shafa'a that is sought from other than Allah jalla wa ala. For example, a person, he calls upon others besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that which obviously cannot harm or benefit him, and not able to do what he wants them to do, he calls upon these people or he calls upon these things and he asks them to intermediate between him and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is shirk. Calling upon others besides Allah jalla wa ala is shirk. Allah jalla wa ala, he says in the Quran, وَأَنَّ الْمَسَاجِدَ لِلَّهِ فَلَا تَدْعُ مَعَ اللَّهِ أَحَدًا. Verily the masajid, the mosques, the places of worship are for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so do not call upon others besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in them. Likewise, Allah jalla wa ala, he mentions in the Quran, وَيَعْبُدُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ مَا لَا يَضُرُّهُمْ وَلَا يَنْفَعُهُمْ وَيَقُولُونَ هَؤُلَاءِ شُفَعَاؤُنَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, referring to the mushrikeen, the polytheists, he says, and they worship besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that which does not benefit them nor harm them. And they say, these are our intercessors with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Allah jalla wa ala, he says, قُلْ أَتُنَبِّئُونَ اللَّهَ بِمَا لَا يَعْلَمُ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَلَا فِي الْأَرْضِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى عَمَّا يُشْرِكُونَ. Say, do you inform Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of that which he does not know in the heavens and the earth? Glory be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala over that which you ascribe to him. So Allah jalla wa ala called their worship of other than him, yani shirk. He called it shirk. And their argument, the argument of the mushrikeen, was that these are our intercessors besides Allah. The only reason we call upon them and we ask them and so on and so forth is so that they may intercede with us before Allah, or they intercede with Allah for us. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he called this shirk. Allah jalla wa ala, he deemed it polytheism. And this is something that many of the kuffar from the other religions do. And sadly some Muslims as well. For example, Catholics, who are a Christian sect, they call upon their saints. They believe in saints, and they call upon their saints, and they seek intercession through their saints. And this is something which is polytheistic in nature. It is shirk. This is what the people of the past used to do before them, and nothing has changed with them. In fact, some Christians refute Catholics. Their own Christian brethren, they refute them and accuse them of polytheism. Because they call upon the saints, they call upon humans, they call upon angels, and they call upon Mary, the mother of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. And they ask, if you ever read their doctrine, if you read the belief of these Catholics, they will tell you that these saints, they are mediators between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They intercede on our behalf. They have the power and the ability to hear our prayers and answer our prayers and take our prayers to God, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then He answers them for us. And of course, this is shirk. This is polytheism. Because when a person calls upon, you make dua to something, you call out to somebody, you are now attaching your heart to that person. You have this hope in your heart that He's going to answer your dua, or He's going to hear it, and then He's going to ask Allah, and then your dua is going to be answered. This state that you have in the heart of hope and yani fear and love and reverence and so on and so forth should only be directed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and nobody else. Whenever you need something, whenever a person experiences any hardship or problems, then your heart should automatically connect to Allah jalla wa ala. It should not turn to the dead. It should not turn to the prophets or the angels, the messengers, or whomsoever it is from humankind. Rather, you should call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Al-Wahid al-Qahhar, Al-Hayy al-Qayyum, the one who is almighty, the one who is ever living, and He does not die. However, these people, the Christians and like them, and from the Hindus for example as well, they call upon other deities besides Allah jalla wa ala. They direct their worship to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And of course, we know that dua is an act of worship. The Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, he said, "Ad-du'a'u huwa al-ibadah." Dua is worship. It is the essence of worship. Allah jalla wa ala, he says in the Quran, "Waqala rabbukum ud'uni astajib lakum. Inna alladhina yastakbiruna 'an 'ibadati sayadkhuluna jahannama dakhirin." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, and your Lord says, call upon Me, I will respond to you. Those who are too arrogant to worship Me, then I will enter them into hell in humiliation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has clearly ordered us in this verse, وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمْ أُدْعُونِي, and your Lord says, call upon Me. This is a command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to worship Him, to call upon Him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He orders something in the Quran, and the ulama, they say that whenever Allah jalla wa ala orders to do something or orders us to do something, أَنَّ الْأَمَرَ يَقْتَضِي الْوُجُوبِ, this is a command that dictates obligation. You have to do it. It is a must. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders you, for example, He says, أَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ, establish the prayer. Is that an obligation or a choice? An obligation. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَآتُ الزَّكَاةِ, and give the zakat. Is this a choice or an obligation? An obligation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He says, وَأَتِمُّ الْحَجَّ وَالْعُمَرَةَ لِلَّهِ, complete the hajj and the umrah for Allah. Is this a choice or an obligation? It's an obligation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He obligates many things in the Quran, and from them is dua. وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمْ أُدْعُونِي, and your Lord says, call upon Me. Look how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has worded it. وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمْ, your Lord. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is establishing His tawheed, His rububiyyah, upon the people by saying that I am your Lord. I am the one who created you. I am the one who fashioned you and sustained you and provides for you. I am the one who created the heavens and the earth. I am the one who looks after all of creation. I am your Lord. وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمْ أُدْعُونِي, and your Lord says, call upon Him. Make dua to Him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never said, call upon others besides Me, call upon the angels, call upon the prophets, call upon the messengers, call upon the saints, call upon this and call upon that. No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala singled Himself out in dua. وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمْ ادْعُونِي, call upon Me. Nobody else. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala straight away after that, what did He say? أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ, I will respond to you. This is a complete conviction from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He will respond to the dua. Whatever person, any dua he makes, Allah responds to it. Either by answering his dua, either by giving him something which is far better than what he asks for, or he delays it, or he answers it by rejecting it, jalla wa ala, because he knows that this for the slave is not good for him, whatever the case is. But it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who answers the dua, nobody else. And it is He who you should single out in dua to, and no one else. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ عَنْ عِبَادَتِي, those people who are too arrogant to worship Me. And look how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He called those who associate partners with Him as arrogant. They have kibr, they have arrogance in their hearts. وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ. And this is what the mushrikeen of Mecca were upon. When you say to them, the people, when you say to these people, لا إله إلا الله, there is nobody worthy of worship except for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You talk to them about tawheed, يستكبرون. They become proud and arrogant. They say, what do you mean, this tawheed? What tawheed? All you do is talk about tawheed, 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 and so on and so forth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, that those who are arrogant, يعني يستكبرون عن عبادتي, they are too arrogant to worship me. And notice how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he called this dua worship. He said, يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ عَنْ عِبَادَتِي. Those who are too proud to worship me, سَيَدْخُلُونَ جَهَنَّمَ دَاخِرِينَ. They will enter or be entered into the hellfire in humiliation. The one who refuses to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he worships other than Allah جَلَّ وَعَلَى, then of course Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enters him into the hellfire. And this is the jaza, this is the reward of the mushrik, the polytheist. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not forgive shirk. Allah does not forgive polytheism. وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَن يَشَاءُ. And he forgives anything apart from that if he wills. Likewise, Allah Jalla wa'ala, he said, وَمَن يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةِ وَمَأْوَاهُ النَّارِ وَمَا لِلظَّالِمِينَ مِنْ أَنصَارِ. Now whomsoever makes shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah has made Jannah, has made paradise haram for that person, forbidden for him. وَمَأْوَاهُ النَّارِ, and his place of residence is the hellfire to remain therein forever. وَمَا لِلظَّالِمِينَ مِنْ أَنصَارِ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, there are no helpers to the ظالمين, the oppressors. Why has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called the mushrikeen and the kuffar oppressors? Does anybody know? Why has Allah Jalla wa Ala called the mushrikeen and the kuffar as oppressors? What oppression have they done? Anybody have any idea? Because they committed shirk. How is shirk oppression?
They did oppress themselves because by doing shirk, mm-hmm. they did
deny the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentioned in the Quran that Luqman alayhi salam said to his son, Ya bunay la tushrik billah, O my son, do not make shirk with Allah. Inna shirka la dhulmun azim. Verily shirk, it is a great oppression. Allah called shirk oppression. Because dhulm, oppression, it means to place something in its improper place. Or not to give the rights of somebody to someone. If you work, for example, in a company, or if you work in a shop or in a business or whatever the case is, and you ask for your wages, for example, you ask for the money that you are owed, and the person, he doesn't give you, or he doesn't pay you on time. This is known as dhulm. This is known as oppression. This person has not given you your due right. Therefore, the one who does not give due right to the creation, he is known as a dhalim, an oppressor. So what about the one who does not give due right to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? He doesn't give the right of Allah Jalla wa Ala to him, but rather he gives the right to Allah to other than him. So instead of making dua sincerely and only to Allah Jalla wa Ala, he makes dua to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He calls upon the prophets, he calls upon the saints, he calls upon the righteous, he calls upon the angels. Is this not dhulm? Is this not oppression that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran? That is why Allah Jalla wa Ala, he called them dhalimeen, because they gave the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to other than him, by way of making shirk. Shirk is defined as تَسْوِيَةُ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ بِاللَّهِ فِي مَا هُوَ مِنْ خَصَائِسِ اللَّهِ. It is to equate other than Allah Jalla wa Ala with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that which is only for Allah Jalla Jalaluhu. When you give the rights of Allah to a human or to anybody other than him, then you have committed shirk. And this is dhulm. This is oppression. And it is the greatest form of oppression that anybody can commit. That is why Allah Jalla wa Ala said about them, وَمَأْوَاهُ النَّارِ, and their resting place for eternity is the hellfire. And of course there is no rest there, but that is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has worded it. This is where they will remain for in forever. Likewise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, he says, as it comes in the hadith in Bukhari, and the authority of Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he said that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, مَنْ مَاتَ وَهُوَ يَدْعُ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ نِدًّا دخل النار. He said عليه الصلاة والسلام, whomsoever dies, and he used to call upon others besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a rival to Allah jalla wa ala, then he will enter into the hellfire. And like I mentioned before, this is what some Christians do and Hindus do and others from the religions of kufr and disbelief. This is also some of the belief of some Muslims as well, sadly, that they call upon the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They say, Ya Rasulallah, ishfa'li indallah. O Messenger of Allah, I seek intercession with you in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like now, in the dunya, they call upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam seeking intercession. Or they call upon the awliya, the righteous slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they ask them to intercede for them on their behalf. And of course, this is shirk, the same shirk of the people of the Christians or the people of Hinduism and so on and so forth. This is what they do with their prophets. The Christians, they say, oh Jesus, help me and save me and intercede for me. They call upon him and Allah called it shirk. Likewise, those Muslims who have fallen into this shirk, they call upon the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, or they call upon the awliya, and they call upon others besides Allah jalla wa ala seeking intercession. This is the same shirk as the people of Mecca, as the mushrikeen of Mecca. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Quran, قُلْ لِلَّهِ الشَّفَاعَةُ جَمِيعًا. Say, to Allah belongs all of the intercession. The intercession is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they will only, a person will only intercede if Allah jalla wa ala wants him to and gives permission. And we will go over, inshaAllah, the conditions of shafa'ah. But that is the first type of shafa'ah. The shafa'ah which is negated, rejected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is a shafa'ah that is sought from other than him, jalla wa ala, to call upon others besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is known as shafa'ah manfiya, which is shirkiyah. It is polytheistic and it is rejected by Allah jalla wa ala. The second type of shafa'ah intercession is الشفاعة المثبتة. The shafa'ah which is affirmed, or the shafa'ah which is granted, the shafa'ah which is accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وهي التي تطلب من الله وحده لا شريك له. It is that shafa'ah, that intercession, that it is only sought from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and no one other than him. So when you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, oh Allah, make me from those whom the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam will intercede for, or you do those actions and you make those du'as that make you from those whom the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam will intercede for yawm al-qiyamah, or you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bestow and bless upon you the chance to, or for you to have shafa'ah made for you. This is how shafa'ah is sought from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. So we don't call upon the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, we don't call upon the awliya, we don't call upon the righteous, we don't call upon any other prophet, no angels. We call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, asking him to make us from those whom the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam will make shafa'ah for. Allah jalla wa ala, or in fact the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, was asked by Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu this very same question. He said radiallahu ta'ala anhu arda, he said, Ya Rasulallah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, man as'ad an-nas yawm al-qiyamah bi shafa'atik, aw man as'ad an-nas bi shafa'atika yawm al-qiyamah, aw Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who are those people who will be the most happy in regards to your shafa'ah, your intercession yawm al-qiyamah? So the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam, he said, as'ad an-nas يوم القيامة بشفاعتي أو بشفاعتي يوم القيامة من قال لا إله إلا الله خالصا من قلبه أو من نفسه. He said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the most happiest people on that day regarding my intercession will be those people who said لا إله إلا الله sincerely from their hearts, or sincerely from themselves. So it is the people of Tawheed, the people of monotheism, whom the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will intercede for and accept their intercession. The people of At-Tawheed. This kalima la ilaha illallah, it is a kalima that all of you know, all of you recite, all of you say. But what about its meanings? What does it mean? What does it truly mean? What does it imply and what does it entail? And how does one personify that in his or her life? This statement, la ilaha illallah, is comprised of two pillars, affirmation and negation. When you say La ilaha, there is nobody worthy of worship in truth, you are negating anything in this created creation that can be worshipped besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then you say Illallah, except for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is the creator of this creation, only He deserves to be worshipped alone and nobody else but Him. This is what La ilaha illallah means, to negate all worship from other than Allah jalla wa ala, and to make your heart and your actions and your statements sincerely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And a person who does this, he lives knowing that his Lord sees him and he hears him and he knows about him and that he should worship him only, and so on and so forth. This person has personified Tawheed. This is the person whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has blessed and in fact created him. This person realizes the purpose of his creation, the objective of his creation. Like Allah jalla wa ala mentioned, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I did not create mankind nor jinn except to worship me alone. So a person who has actualized Tawheed has fulfilled his objective in this dunya. He has fulfilled his objective in this life. And of course, it is that objective that we just mentioned. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I did not create mankind nor jinn except to worship me alone. That is the only reason why we've been placed upon this earth. That is the only reason as to why we are alive today and that we breathe. We have been created for the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and devotion to Him alone. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentions in the Quran, وَلَا يَشْفَعُونَ إِلَّا لِمَنِ ارْتَضَى. And He, meaning they, will not intercede except for those whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are pleased with. Shafa'ah will only take place for those whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with, and nobody else. The shafa'ah of the mushrikeen and the polytheists and the kuffar will not be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And of course, like we mentioned the verse previously, قُلِ اللَّهِ الشَّفَاعَةُ جَمِيعًا. Say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala belongs all of the shafa'ah, all of the intercession. And of course, intercession, it has its conditions. There are three conditions to a shafa'ah, to this intercession. The first is إِذْنُ اللَّهِ تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى لِلشَّافِعِ أَنْ يَشْفَاعَ. The first one is the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to intercede. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has to give the intercessor permission to intercede, first and foremost. Secondly, رِضَاهُ تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى عَنِ الْمَشْفُوعِ لَهُ. That Allah is pleased for the one who is being interceded for. That person who the intercession is for, Allah has to be pleased with that person. That's the second condition. And the third condition is, لَا يَرْضَ اللَّهُ تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى إِلَّا عَنْ أَهْلِ التَّوْحِيدِ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not be pleased except with the people of Tawheed. The people who worship Allah jalla wa ala alone, devote their life to Him jalla wa ala alone, and they venerate Him subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. These are the three conditions to ash-shafa'ah. And of course, they all have their respected evidences. In regards to the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the intercessor to intercede, then Allah jalla wa ala mentions, like in Surah Al-Baqarah, in Ayat Al-Kursi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what did He say towards the end? مَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَشْفَعُ عِنْدَهُ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِهِ. Who is there that can intercede with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala except by way of His permission? This gives us the idea and the notion and the belief that no one will intercede in this dunya except by way of permission of Allah. Likewise in the akhirah, no one will intercede except that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them permission to do so. So those people who seek intercession today, how do they know that their intercession will be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How do they know that Allah jalla wa ala has given the permission for the prophets and the righteous to give intercession or to do intercession right now? This is one refutation against them. That intercession will only come when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives permission to do so. Likewise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, مَا مِن شَفِيعٍ إِلَّا مِن بَعْدِ إِذْنِهِ. There is absolutely no intercessor except after His permission, or except after His permission is given. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives permission to intercede, only then will they intercede. Likewise, in regards to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being pleased with the one who intercession is being done for, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says in the Quran, وَكَمْ مِنْ مَلَكٍ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ لَا تُغْنِي شَفَاعَتُهُمْ شَيْئًا إِلَّا مِنْ بَعْدِ أَنْ يَأْذَنَ اللَّهُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيَرَضَى. How many angels are there in the sky whose shafa'ah, whose intercession will not avail them and help them in any way whatsoever, except after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give permission for whomsoever He wants and whom He is pleased with. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned here that in order for them to intercede, He has to give permission, and after that, He has to be pleased with those who are interceded for. And of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not be pleased for the intercession of a disbeliever or a mushrik or a munafiq. And that leads us to our third condition, and the evidence for it is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is only pleased with the people of Tawheed. Like Allah jalla wa ala mentioned, or like the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was, who is the most happiest of the shafa'ah, of your shafa'ah yawm al-qiyamah, ya Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam? And he said, those who say la ilaha illallah sincerely from their hearts. This is a dalil that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is only pleased with the people of Tawheed. Because Allah jalla wa ala, by default, has cursed the disbelievers. Inna Allaha la'ana al-kafirina wa a'adda lahum sa'ira. Allah has cursed the disbelievers and He has prepared for him the fire. Khalidina fiha abada, la yajiduna fiha waliyan wa la nasira. They will remain therein forever. They will have no helpers or protectors. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by default has rejected the shafa'ah of the kuffar and the mushrikeen. However, there is only one kafir, and as the ulama they mentioned, that intercession will be done for him. Not to be taken out the hellfire, but for his punishment to be reduced. Does anybody know who that disbeliever is? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's uncle. And what was his name? Abu Talib. Abu Talib is the only disbeliever, as per the text of the Quran and the Sunnah, which prove that his intercession will be lightened, his punishment will be lightened after the intercession of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Not that he will exit the hellfire, but rather that his intercession, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's intercession for him, would mean that his punishment in the hellfire is lightened. He'll continue to be punished forever, but it's just lightened for the good that he did for the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wa salam. And that brings us on to the Shafa'atul Udma, the greatest Shafa'ah that will take place Yawm al-Qiyamah for the believers. And this is a Shafa'ah that on the Day of Resurrection, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gathers mankind for judgment, all of them will be waiting, they would anticipate their judgment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And of course the people naturally will be scared. It will be a day when even the Prophets alayhi salatu wasalam, all the Prophets of Allah jalla wa ala, they will make a dua and they will say, Allahumma sallim sallim. Oh Allah, we ask for your safety and security. If the Prophets of Allah are afraid of that day, and this is the dua they're making, oh Allah, we ask you for your safety and security, then what about us as normal Muslims? How will we feel that day? And especially the kuffar, how will they feel on that day? Knowing that they rejected Allah Jalla wa Ala and rejected His worship and they made shirk and so on and so forth. But there is a hadith that inshallah we will read to you. The hadith found in Bukhari, it is a long hadith and it is regarding the Shafa'atul Udma. Bukhari, he brings in his Sahih where he mentions a hadith on the authority of one of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, Abu Huraira radiallahu an. He said, I came to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with some meat. And when he alayhi salatu wasalam put his hand out to eat this meat, it was the dhira', the forearm of a lamb. And this was the most favorite part of the meat that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to eat. And when he was taking from it and eating from it, he said alayhi salatu wasalam, ana sayyidun nasi yawm al-qiyamah. I am the master of the people on the Day of Resurrection. So this is a dalil to show that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam is the best of mankind. He is the best of all of mankind that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is created. Ana sayyidun nasi yawm al-qiyamah. I am the master of mankind on the Day of Resurrection. وَهَلْ تَدْرُونَ مِمَّا ذَلِكَ. And do you know for what reason that is? يَجْمَعُ اللَّهُ النَّاسَ الْأَوَّلِينَ وَالْآخِرِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He will gather all of the people, the first of them and the last of them. فِي صَعِيدٍ وَاحِدٍ يُسْمِعُهُمُ الدَّاعِ وَيَنْفُذُهُمُ الْبَصُرِ. He will guide them to a place where they will all stand and they will hear and they will see everything that will take place. وَتَدْنُ الشَّمْسِ. And the sun will be brought down very close over the heads of the people. فَيَبْلُغُ النَّاسَ مِنَ الْغَمِّ وَالْكَرْبِ مَا لَا يَطِيقُونَ وَلَا يَحْتَمِلُونَ. And when the sun, it is over their heads, of course the heat and the intense trouble that will be at that time, it will be too much for them to bear. And of course, this is something that no human can bear. A very frightening scene, a very panicky scene, if you would. People will be worried. The sun will be close over their heads. They will experience this intense heat. They won't be able to take the punishment that they are going through, the pain that they are going through. فَيَقُولُ النَّاسُ أَلَا تَرَوْنَ مَا قَدْ بَلَغَكُمْ. Then the people, they will say, do you not see what is happening to you? Look at all what is happening to you. The sun is over your heads. We are burning, it is hot. We are afraid, we are frightened. We have sins. So they will say to one another, look at what is happening to us. أَلَا تَنْظُرُونَ مَنْ يَشْفَعُ لَكُمْ إِلَى رَبِّكُمْ. Is there anybody who will intercede before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? فَيَقُولُ بَعْضُ النَّاسِ لِبَعْضُ عَلَيْكُمْ بِآدَمُ. So some of the people will say to the others, upon you is to go to Adam. Go to Adam, the Prophet Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. فَيَأْتُونَ Adam. So they will go to Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. فَيَقُولُونَ لَهُ. They will say to him, أَنْتَ أَبُو الْبَشَرِ خَلَقَكَ اللَّهُ بِيَدِهِ وَنَفَخَ فِيكَ مِنْ رُوحِهِ وَأَمَرَ الْمَلَائِكَةَ فَسَجَدُوا لَكَ. They will say, O Adam, you are the father of mankind. You are the one whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created with his own hand. And you are the one whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blew his spirit into. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered all of the angels to make sajda to you. Ishfa' lana ila rabbika. Intercede for us in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ala tara ila ma nahnu fi. Do you not see what state we are in? So then Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, he will turn around and he will say, Inna Rabbi qad ghadiba al-yawma ghadaban lam yaghdab qablahu mithlahu. He said, my Lord is so angry on this day that he will never ever be angry after this day, and he was never angry before this day. وَلَنْ يَغْضَبْ بَعْدَهُ مِثْلَهُ. And he will never be angry after this day, the like of it. وَإِنَّهُ قَدْ نَهَانِي عَنِ الشَّجَرَةِ فَعَسَيْتُهُ. My Lord told me not to eat from the tree, and I ate from the tree. I sinned against him. نَفْسِي نَفْسِي نَفْسِي. I am worried about myself. I am worried about myself. اِذْهَبُوا إِلَى غَيْرِي. Go to somebody other than me. اِذْهَبُوا إِلَى نُوحٍ. Go to Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam. Go to the Prophet Nuh. The first messenger alayhi salatu wasalam to Allah sent to mankind was who? Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam. فَيَأْتُونَ نُوحًا فَيَقُولُونَ يَا نُوح إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ أَوَّلَ الرُّسُلِ إِلَى أَهْلِ الْأَرْضِ. So they will go to Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam and they will say, O Nuh, you are the first messenger that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent to the people of the earth. وَقَدْ سَمَّاكَ اللَّهُ عَبْدًا شَكُورًا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called you his thankful servant. اِشْفَعْ لَنَا إِلَى رَبِّكَ. Intercede for us on our behalf in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَلَا تَرَى إِلَى مَا نَحْنُ فِيهِ. Do you not see what state we are in? فَيَقُولُ. So Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam will say, إِنَّ رَبِّي عَزَّ وَجَلْ قَدْ غَضِبَ الْيَوْمَ غَضَبًا لَمْ يَغْضَبْ قَبْلَهُ مِثْلَهُ وَلَنْ يَغْضَبَ بَعْدَهُ مِثْلَهُ. Verily, my Lord is very angry on this day. He was never this angry, and he will never be angry like it again. وَإِنَّهُ قَدْ كَانَتْ لِدَعْوَةٌ دَعَوْتُهَا عَلَىٰ قَوْمِ. As for me, there was one supplication that Allah accepted, and that was the supplication against my people. نَفْسِي نَفْسِي نَفْسِي. I am worried about myself. I am worried about myself. اِذْهَبُوا إِلَىٰ غَيْرِي. اِذْهَبُوا إِلَىٰ إِبْرَاهِيمِ. He will say, go to somebody other than me. In fact, go to Ibrahim. فَيَأْتُونَ إِبْرَاهِيمِ فَيَقُولُونَ يَا إِبْرَاهِيمُ أَنْتَ نَبِيُّ اللَّهِ وَخَلِيلُهُ مِنَ أَهْلِ الْأَرْضِ. So they will go to Ibrahim عليه الصلاة والسلام and they will say, يَا إِبْرَاهِيمُ, you are the Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his close friend from the people of the earth. اِشْفَعْ لَنَا إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ. intercede for us to your Lord on our behalf. أَلَا تَرَى إِلَى مَا نَحْنُ فِيهِ Do you not see what state we are in? فَيَقُولُ لَهُمْ إِنَّ رَبِّي قَدْ غَضِبَ غَضَبًا لَمْ يَغْضَبْ قَبْلَهُ مِثْلَهُ وَلَنْ يَغْضَبْ بَعْدَهُ مِثْلَهُ Verily, my Lord is so angry on this day that he was never angry like this before and he will never be angry like it again. وَإِنِّي قَدْ كُنْتُ كَذَبْتُ ثَلَاثَ كَذَبَاتٍ As for me, O كَذِبَاتٍ I lied three times in my life. And of course, he was afraid of his sin. So he said, نَفْسِي, نَفْسِي, نَفْسِي. I am worried about myself. I am worried about myself. اِذْهَبُ إِلَى غَيْرِي Go to somebody apart from me. اِذْهَبُ إِلَى مُوسَى Go to Musa عليه الصلاة والسلام. فَيَأْتُونَ مُوسَى فَيَقُولُونَ يَا مُوسَى They will go to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam and they will say, O Musa, O Moses, Anta Rasul Allah, you are the Messenger of Allah, faddalaka Allah bi risalatihi wa kalamihi ala an-nas. You are the one whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave his risala, meaning he's the one who gave you the Torah and he is the one who spoke to you directly from amongst the people. Ishfa' lana ila rabbika, intercede for us with your Lord on our behalf. أَلَا تَرَى إِلَى مَا نَحْنُ فِيهِ Do you not see what state we are in? فَيَقُولْ He will say, إِنَّ رَبِّي قَدْ غَذِبَ الْيَوْمَ غَذَبًا لَمْ يَغْذَبْ قَبْلَهُ وَلَا مِثْلَهُ وَلَنْ يَغْذَبُ بَعْدَهُ مِثْلَهُ Verily, my Lord is so angry on this day. He has never been angry like this, nor will he ever be angry like this ever again. Then he will say, إِنِّي قَدْ قَتَلْتُ نَفْسًا لَمْ أُمَرْ بِقَتْلِهَا نَفْسِي نَفْسِي نَفْسِي, نفسي. As for me, then I killed a soul that I was not ordered to kill. I'm worried about my own sin. Nafsi, nafsi, nafsi. I'm worried about myself. I'm worried about myself. Then he will say, اِذْهَبُ إِلَى غَيْرِي Go to somebody other than me. اِذْهَبُ إِلَى عِيسَى بْنُ مَرْيَمْ Go to Jesus, the son of Mary. Go to Isa عليه الصلاة والسلام. فَيَأْتُونَ عِيسَى عَلَيْهِ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ فَيَقُولُونَ يَا عِيسَى أَنْتَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ وكلمته ألقاها إلى مريم وروح من وكلمت الناس في المهدي صبيا They will say, O Isa, O Jesus, you are the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم You are his prophet, you are his messenger and you are the one whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created by way of his word and you are the spirit that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala he gave the spirit and aided you by it or with it and you are the one who spoke to the people in the cradle They will say, اشفع لنا إلى ربك ألا ترى إلى ما نحن فيه They will say, O Isa, intercede for us or on our behalf with your Lord. Do you not see the state that we are in? So then he will say, إن ربي غضب The same phrase, غضب اليوم غضبا لم يغضب قبله مثله أو مثله ولن يغضب وَلَنْ يَغْضَبَ بَعْدَهُ مِثْلَهُ My Lord, He's very angry on this day. He was never angry before and He will never be angry again like it. نَفْسِي, نَفْسِي, نَفْسِي I am afraid, I am scared for myself. I am scared for myself. يعني I'm worried about myself. اِذْهَبُ إِلَى غَيْرِي Go to somebody other than me. And look at who Isa عليه الصلاة والسلام told them to go to. They said, or he said عليه الصلاة والسلام, اذهبوا إلى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم Go to Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم فيأتون محمدا عليه الصلاة والسلام فيقولون يا محمد أنت رسول الله وخاتم الأنبياء وقد غفر الله لك ما تقدم من ذنبك وما تأخر اشفع لنا إلى ربك ألا ترى إلى ما نحن فيه So they will go to the Messenger of Allah عليه الصلاة والسلام and they will say, O Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم You are the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and you are the seal of all the prophets and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forgiven all of your sins. Intercede for us on our behalf with your Lord. Do you not see the state that we are in? So the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wa sallam, he said, فَأَنْطَلِقُوا فَآتِيَ تَحْتَ الْعَرْشِ فَأَقْعُوا سَاجِدًا لِرَبِّ عَزَّ وَجَلْ He said, I will go to the throne of my Lord. He will go to the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he will prostrate in front of the throne of Allah jalla wa ala. ثُمَّ يَفْتَحُ اللَّهُ عَلَيَّ مِنْ مَحَامِدِهِ وَحُسْنِ الثَّنَاءِ عَلَيْهِ شَيْئًا لَمْ يَفْتَحُ عَلَى أَحَدٍ قَبْلِ Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will inspire me with certain words, with a certain supplication that was not inspired to anybody before me. ثُمَّ يُقَالْ Then it will be said, Ya Muhammad, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, irfa ra'sak, raise your head, sal tu'ta, ask and you will be given, washfa' tushaffa', intercede, for verily your intercession will be accepted. Then the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, he said, فَأَرْفَعُ رَأْسِي فَأَقُولُ أُمَّتِي يَا رَبْ أُمَّتِي. He will say, O my Lord, my Ummah, my Ummah. And then he alayhi salatu wasalam will intercede for his Ummah, for his nation. He will make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to take out from the hellfire those of the sinners from the Ummah of Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. This is who will intercede for us Yawm al-Qiyamah. When all the prophets alayhi salatu wasalam will not be able to, Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam will intercede for us. My prophet and your prophet, my messenger and yours, the one whose sunnah we neglect, the one who we don't follow in his actions and his statements and his characteristics, the one who came as the final messenger for mankind to teach us and show us the straight path in the right way. He's the one, alayhi salatu wasalam, who will intercede for us. Even though we neglected the deen of Allah jalla wa ala and his sunnah, he, alayhi salatu wasalam, his love for us will always remain. And he will say that day, Allahumma ummati ummati, O Rabbi ummati ummati, O my Lord, my ummah, my nation, my nation. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept the intercession of the Messenger of Allah, alayhi salatu wasalam, and he will enter the usat, the major sinners, into paradise after they have been burnt in the hellfire. Wa'iyadhum billah. And this is something that inshallah we all hope for, and we make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah jalla wa ala count us and accept us from those whom the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam will intercede for yawm al-qiyamah. Ameen. And may Allah jalla wa ala enter us all into his paradise. Allahumma ameen. Wallahu a'lam. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. There are other hadith. So the question was, apart from the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, who else will intercede? Of course, there are those who will intercede. The angels will intercede for the believers after Allah gives them permission. The other Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam will intercede for their people. It is mentioned in a hadith that a child will intercede for his parents. That unborn child that dies will also intercede for the parents. Likewise, the Quran will be an intercessor for the one who recites it, as is mentioned in the hadith. Likewise, the siyam, a fasting of a person, will also intercede for him, yawm al-qiyamah, his good deeds. So there are others who will intercede for the believers, yawm al-qiyamah, not just the Messenger of Allah, alayhi salatu wasalam, but his will be the first intercession, the first and the greatest intercession. That is why it's called the shafa'at al-uzma, the greatest intercession, and that is the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wasalam. Then after that, these things or these people will also intercede for the ummah, or the respective ummah. Wallahu alam. I think that's it. Allahu a'lam wa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.